Leia here from leiafirstsci.com, and in this video, I will show you how to name branched substituents. In other words, we'll look at molecules that have a substituent coming off of another substituent. We'll use this molecule as our first example. We name the branched substituent using the same rules that we introduced in the first video. The first thing we want to do is identify the parent chain or the longest carbon chain and highlight to mark it, and then we'll number the parent chain. Given that I have four carbons from the right and four carbons from the left, it doesn't matter where I start. I have a total of nine carbons, giving me a first name of non, only single bonds in the chain giving me a last name of ane. This molecule gets tricky when you look at the substituent. If we only had the straight chain with three carbons as a substituent, this would be a propyl. However, we have a branch coming off the molecule, which changes the rule slightly. When you're naming a substituent, you treat it almost as if it's a new molecule that you have to name, and you start out by identifying the parent chain on the substituent, where carbon number one is the carbon that is attached to the parent chain. I have two methyl groups coming off the second carbon, so it doesn't matter which one I number as three. I have a total of three carbons in the longest substituent chain, which gives me a propyl group. Prop telling me 3 and YL telling me that it's a substituent, and then I have a methyl group coming off of the second carbon, which gives me a 2-methyl propyl. However, since this entire substituent comes off of carbon 5 on the parent chain, I put a 5 in front of the name and then put the entire substituent in parentheses. This gives me a final name for this molecule of 5-2-methylpropylnonane. Let's try another example, and this one is slightly tricky. At first glance, this appears to be my parent chain. However, when you look closer, coming off of this carbon, we have only two on the left, but we have three carbons going down, which means my parent chain actually has to curve downward. I start numbering the chain from the bottom carbon because I reach my substituent group at 4, whereas if I started from the top right, I would reach my substituent at 5. Having 8 carbons in my parent chain gives me a first name of oct. Having only single bonds gives me a last name of ane. Once again, we find that we have a branched chain substituent. We number the carbon coming off the parent chain as 1, and another of the carbons as 2. Since I have 2 carbons in my substituent chain, this gives me an ethyl. But coming off of the first carbon, I have a methyl group, which gives me a 1-methyl. The entire substituent is coming off of carbon 4, which gives me a 4-1-methylethyl for a final name of 4-1-methylethyl octane. We'll use this method on one more example, and then I'll show you a shortcut. If we highlight our longest carbon chain, you recognize that we have a total of 10 carbons. I have to number this chain from the left because I hit my substituent at carbon number 4. 10 carbons in my parent chain gives me a first name of dec. Only single bonds gives me a last name of ane. This substituent is exciting because in addition to a parent chain of 2 carbons, we have 2 substituents coming off my substituent. The parent chain of the substituent has 2 carbons, giving me the name ethyl. But coming off of the ethyl, I have 2 methyl groups on carbon number 1. And so I named them 1,1-dimethyl. Since the entire substituent comes off of carbon number 4, we put 4 dash parentheses for a substituent named 1,1-dimethylethyl. For a final name of 4,1,1-dimethylethyldecane. If naming those branched substituents were a little tedious, I have good news. There are certain substituents that have an accepted abbreviation and are so much easier to name. I'll use R to represent the rest of the molecule, meaning the parent chain, so that we can focus on only the substituents. If you have a substituent of 3 carbons in a row, assuming all associated hydrogens are present, this is called a propyl substituent. However, when you have a substituent that is 3 carbons attached to the parent chain by the second instead of the first carbon, you have the option to name this substituent 1-methylethyl or you can use the shortcut for this name, which is isopropyl. The prefix iso, or isomer, tells you that we have the same molecular formula as a propyl substituent, however it's connected in a different way. In other words, the isopropyl is a constitutional isomer of the standard or normal propyl substituent. When written out in line structure, the standard propyl is written as follows. The first end is attached to the R group or parent chain and doesn't count, so we just have 3 carbons coming off of the substituent, while the isopropyl looks as follows. Once again, this represents the bond between the parent chain and the substituent, and we have the 3 carbons attached at the second rather than the first carbon. There are 4 isomers of a 4-carbon substituent. The first one, having 4 carbons in a row with associated hydrogens, is considered a normal butyl substituent. Bute meaning 4. However, you can have isomers of this represented in a number of ways. When you have your 4 carbons in a row, however, the group is connected to the parent chain by the second rather than the first carbon, this would be named as a 1-methylpropyl substituent, but can also be named sec-butyl. Sec meaning secondary because the carbon attached to the parent chain has 2 carbon atoms coming off of it within the substituent alone. If I have a similar chain where an isomer of this substituent has 3 carbons in a row, but instead of the 4th carbon coming off the first substituent carbon, it comes off of the second one. The long name for this would be 2-methylpropyl, or you can name this isobutyl, given that this is an isomer of the butyl substituent. And last but not least, you can have a 4-carbon substituent where 1 carbon is attached to the parent chain and the other 3 carbons are attached to this first carbon. The long name for this substituent would be 1,1-dimethylethyl, but you can also call this substituent tertiary or simply tert-butyl. And that's because the carbon that is directly attached to the parent chain has 3 carbons coming off of it within the substituent. Now let's see how each of these would look in line structure. For the normal butyl, I simply have 4 carbons coming off of a parent chain. For the sec-butyl, I have 3 carbons coming off the parent chain with a branch coming off that first carbon. For the isobutyl, I have that same substituent of 3 carbons, but my branch comes from the second to last carbon. And finally, for the tert-butyl, I have 2 carbons and 2 branches, all originating at the same area. Many students often confuse the isobutyl with the sec-butyl, so we want to show you a little trick. Let's compare the isobutyl to the isopropyl, which looked like this. And I want you to notice that both the isopropyl and the isobutyl have the branch chain at the end, which is how you can recognize the iso group. And now that we know how to name the special isomers, let's go back to our original problems and see if we can make those names shorter. For our first example of 5-2-methylpropyl nonane, if we analyze the substituent, recognize that this is an isomer of butyl with that fork or branch at the end, which means this is an isobutyl group. This gives me the simpler name of 5-isobutyl nonane. Our second example of 4,1-methylethyl octane can be recognized as an isomer of a propyl substituent, and once again the branch tail helps you recognize that it's an isopropyl group. Renaming this molecule, I get 4-isopropyl octane. Our final example of 4,1,1-dimethylethyl decane looks a lot less scary when you recognize that this is simply an isomer of the butyl substituent. Since we have a central carbon with 3 carbons coming off of it, we recognize it as a tert-butyl, giving me a final name of 4-tert-butyl decane. Be sure to join me in the next video where I show you how to name cyclic and bicyclic alkanes. Are you struggling with organic chemistry? Are you looking for information to guide you through the course and help you succeed? If so, download my ebook, 10 Secrets to Acing Organic Chemistry, using the link below, or visit leahforsci.com/orgosecrets. That's O-R-G-O secrets. For information regarding online tutoring, visit leahforsci.com/orgotutor. That's O-R-G-O tutor. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and even share it with a friend or two. If you have any questions regarding this video, leave a comment below or contact me through my Facebook page at facebook.com/leahforsci. There will be many related videos posted over the course of the semester, so go ahead and click the subscribe button to ensure that you don't miss out.